Good afternoon, everyone. Great to see so many people here. And welcome to this session about using GraphQL with React and why GraphQL is so incredibly cool. So what are we going to talk about? Basically, why you'd want to use GraphQL and what it is. Like, I'm kind of assuming that most people are not really familiar with GraphQL. And just to check whether that's true, how many of you have used GraphQL before? So, like, maybe 10% of the room. And how many of you use React? So that's about half of the room. Kind of what I figured. Good. So I'll show you why GraphQL is so cool, why you might want to use it. And then again, some of the drawbacks, because it's not a silver bullet. And, well, we'll get to that later. So who am I? My name is Maurice de Beijer. I'm from the Netherlands. I teach, I develop, I coach, and I do a lot of stuff. I do a lot on the back end with .NET or Node, and a lot in the front end with React, of course, but also with Angular or just plain JavaScript. And I also teach, and partly online, partly classroom teaching, but I've got a couple of courses on Skillshare. The last one is about what's new in React 16.3. But that's not why we're here. We're here about GraphQL. And what's GraphQL? It's a query language. But the name GraphQL, SQL, structured query language, kind of suggests that it's for graph databases. It's not. It's nothing to do with graph databases. So the name is maybe a bit confusing. It's all about querying APIs, querying different APIs in a standard way of doing things. And turns out this comes out of Facebook, just like React does. Doesn't make it particularly better or worse, like your opinion of Facebook doesn't really matter in this, but they do come up with some pretty interesting things once in a while. Sometimes they come up with some pretty crappy things as well, but I think this is pretty interesting and pretty good. So if you go to the GraphQL website, you kind of get this. What's GraphQL? A query language for APIs. But at the top, you can see it describes your data. You describe your data. And then you query your data, and you get a predictable result, which is always nice. So what does it entail? Well, it can query all sorts of data. But typically, it's around hierarchical data. But it's really kind of up to you. You write the backend and you can query whatever you want to. You could query databases, you could query other REST services. Just happens that's done rather often. You could just do processing, use it as a remote procedure call style interface. So the service provides data and it says, okay, this and this is available. Now, if you look at REST services, that means that if the client is going to request some data, it's going to get all of that data back, whether it's actually needed or not. It's something we call overfetching. Well, with GraphQL, that doesn't happen, at least not because of the server. If that happens, it's because you're querying too much. But you define what you need on the client. You create a query there, and you will only get back the data you query for. Of course, you're limited to what the data supplies or the server supplies. You can't query data that's not there. But anything that's there, you can query. And there are lots of ways you can query it. I'll show you some examples later. And some of those will be parameterized. It's not just give me a list of movies, which is what I'm actually going to use. But I can say, well, give me the top 5 movies. Kind of like SQL-like again, but not exactly SQL. You kind of define your own parameters there. So what are some of the advantages? Well, I already mentioned the fact that with REST services, you typically overfetch. A REST service provides a lot of data. That's what you get back, whether you actually need it or not. I've got a little example here. Let me switch here. Here you can see a result, or at least a part of a result from the MovieDB, an online service which will give you data back for movies. And this is what a movie looks like there. And I'll get this back whether I want to or not. If I query for movies, I'm going to get all of these back. Now, there's an overview here. I might just want to display a list of movie titles and their poster image, but nothing else. Do I need to get that back? No. But the RESTful service will give it back to me. In GraphQL, I just tell it, OK, I'm only interested in the title and the image, and that's all I get. Another nice thing is there is a playground. With the RESTful service, it's kind of like you do an HTTP request, and there are tools like Postman you can use to do your queries. But there isn't a lot you can discover there. It's basically you have to know the endpoint, and if there are any query parameters, you kind of have to know that they're there. There is no description around it. Well, with GraphQL, there is. Everything is typed. And I'll show you a bit of an example. I've got a playground here. And right here, I can show you the scheme. And there are a couple of queries I can do, top-rated movies. And that returns a movie object. And over here, I can see that it returns with a specific structure. So there is an ID, which is of type ID, so it's the identity. But there is a title there, which is of type string with an exclamation mark. So it's a string which is always there. It's never null. There is an overview, but that's not with the exclamation mark, so that's actually nullable. So I can completely describe my structure. Now I can use that in the playgrounds to test my queries. I can basically go in there and say, I want to query something, without the quotes. And what can I do? Well, I've got auto-completion, so I can do top-rated movies. And I pressed Ctrl-Enter, and that actually did a query. So by default, it says, well, I'll just do the minimal. I'll do just get the ID. But now I can say, give me something else. I also want the title, and I might want the poster path. So I execute it. I get exactly that data back. We can also parameterize these. In this case, I've added an option there where I can say only take so many movies. So take just 3 movies and leave all the others. So now the result set is limited to just 3 movies. So that's really nice. Another thing with RESTful services is you get back what they call resources. Now, resources are fine. There's nothing wrong with resources. But the idea with RESTful services is you follow the HTTP semantics. And if you want to get something, you use the HTTP get method. If you want to update that, you use the HTTP put method. But quite often, the thing you want to update doesn't exactly match a resource. You might be in a banking application, and you've got a customer there, and he's got a balance on his checking account. Do I want to let him update that balance? Look, oh, I've spent a bit too much money. I'll just update my balance and put some extra money in there. No, it doesn't work that way. So sending the same resource back to the server doesn't always make a lot of sense. Well, with GraphQL, they say we're going to separate updates and queries. And with updates, they'll use something called mutations, where you're going to mutate data. In fact, it's just a remote procedure call, but kind of query and CQRS, command and query responsibility segregation. So you get that out of the box, which I think is great. So there are lots of benefits. I'm just highlighting them. There are actually more benefits, but we'll see a few more in a bit. But there are lots of benefits. So another benefit is the fact that, or at least the fact that you can query for what you need is really great when you're starting to support different clients. Like I've got an iOS application here, an Android application, and a website. Are they going to request the same data from the same endpoint? Probably not. Now they can just specify their needs, and we're all good to go. But quite often, that data doesn't come from a single source. So the GraphQL endpoint on the server will actually go and query different systems. So in this case, we've got some REST service going to the movie DB and getting data from there. But there might be a database where we store user-specific data, and there might be some service we use to predict movies you'd like. Well, based on your history of movies you've watched, we are going to guess you're going to like this and this new movie. Completely different algorithms, completely different APIs, but they're all hidden away by one GraphQL endpoint, and the client just has to make one call to get all the information he wants. So if you compare REST and GraphQL, I think in general, GraphQL has the edge. Not in every case, like there are certain cases where REST is better. And one specific point is caching. GraphQL still goes over HTTP, so it still uses HTTP as the transport. But you'll find that it usually uses an HTTP post. Doesn't have to, it can use an HTTP GET, but mostly it uses HTTP POST. And what's a drawback of an HTTP POST? It's not cacheable, because POST typically mutates state. In this case, even if we query, HTTP thinks, well, it's a POST, so it probably makes a change. So we're not going to cache things, which kind of defeats HTTP caching. Now, there is caching in GraphQL clients, and possibly on the server as well. But that kind of has to re-implement all that HTTP caching again. And it also means there are no intermediaries that can do caching, which doesn't help with performance. Now, generally, GraphQL is pretty fast, so that's not a big issue, but it's a downside. But a lot of the upsides are you've got a type system, so you've got a playground which uses that type system, so you can test and define your queries there. There are standard implementations, both for the server and the client, so there are lots of benefits there. Now, I want to show you how to use this on the clients with React. And there are a couple of implementations you can use for that. Like, GraphQL comes out of Facebook, and of course Facebook also creates React, so you can kind of expect them to create a client for React. And it turns out the bottom one, Relay, is just that. That's Facebook's client for React applications. In fact, the name doesn't quite do it justice here. It's called Relay Modern, like we already have a Relay Old or deprecated or so. Turns out it's actually true. It's a complete rewrite of their first implementation. But I'm not going to use Relay. It's pretty good, but it's also pretty complicated. And another downside, or at least potential downside of Relay, is that it's only for React clients, not for anything else. And much as I love React, I also like Angular and Vue and all the other things, and I don't think you should create endpoints which are only usable by a single client. So I really much prefer to use Apollo, which is much broader. It cares about the server, it cares about the client, it cares about different clients. There is an Apollo client for React. There is an Apollo client for Vue, for Angular. There are server bits there. So Apollo, in general, is much easier to get started with, and there is much more documentation around it. There are even more clients than this. There are a whole bunch of others you could use, but these are the two popular ones, so that's the reason I listed them. It's also, the others are pretty small, so they don't have a nice logo to put on the slide. So if we go to Apollo, the Apollo website, we kind of see this. It's GraphQL over REST. Don't take that too literal, because if you write the server, you don't actually have to use any REST servers whatsoever. But you can see at the top, it's about both client and server. And in fact, the server I've got running is in part built with GraphQL, although we're not going to really look at that. If you're interested in the server bits, come to me afterwards and I'll show you. There isn't a whole lot to it. It's pretty simple, but I don't really have time to do that in the session. So we need to pull in a couple of NPM libraries. And in reality, the minimum you need is these three. In fact, for quite a lot of applications, that's all you need besides React. So Apollo Boost is basically the client which is going to connect to the server. Now, there are different clients. There is also an NPM package called Apollo Client, which, in fact, is used in Apollo Boost under the hood. But Apollo Boost makes it much, much easier. It comes predefined with good defaults, so it will kind of just work where Apollo Client needs but configuration work. So there is React Apollo, which basically gives us components, React components to use with Apollo clients. There are similar packages for Angular, Vue, etc. And the last one, GraphQL, is actually from Facebook itself. It's the parser for the GraphQL query language. You could, in fact, go without it. You could manually build up the object tree there, but it's much, much easier to write that as text and use the GraphQL parser to parse that. So the Apollo Boost project, at least the NPM page, we'll forego that. So the first thing we need to do in our React client is create an Apollo client so we actually connect up to the server. At least I'm assuming here that the server is already running. So you can see we import Apollo and we create a client and specify the URI where it needs to connect. In fact, you could even leave that URI out. By default, it will go to the server where the application is hosted on and go to the GraphQL endpoint there. So if it's hosted on the same server, you can actually even forgo specifying that URI. But in this case, I've got different applications running, so I actually need to go to a different port on localhost. My React application runs on 3000, my GraphQL application runs on 4000. So the next thing was React Apollo, the React components to work with Apollo. And we're going to use a few of those. So first of all, we're going to use a provider, the Apollo provider. And just like many other providers, like you have, for instance, with Redux or with React Router and similar, it just makes things available. This basically makes the client available to other components which will do the actual querying or mutations. But this kind of sits somewhere at a low level in the application. I've actually put it right at the root of the application here. It doesn't need to be there, but wherever you're going to use that client, it has to be nested in here. Now, if you find you need to go to different GraphQL endpoints, you could actually use multiple providers here, as long as they're not nested. You can't nest them, but you can put multiple next to each other. Although, in general, it's probably better to use a single one and consolidate your service at the backend. So that's still pretty easy. Create the Apollo provider, pass in the client we created before, and we're good to start querying. So when we start querying, we need to provide a query, kind of like the one I just wrote in here. So this is the query, where it basically says, OK, go to the top-rated movies, take the first three, give me back the ID, the title, and what is it, the poster path. So that's basically a query. I could make this query more complex. I could make it less complex. But basically, that's what we need inside our application to start parsing things. So if my clicker works, we have a query. Now, you might notice a little funky syntax there. We've got an import of GQL. Actually, the import's not on the slide, but it's supposed to be there. So just ignore that for a moment. But then it's GQL and not brackets or anything. It uses backticks. That's what they call string templates. So it uses a feature of the ECMAScript 2015 template strings, where you can actually use them as a function. So the GQL really is a function, but it's, well, just uses this somewhat weird syntax if you've never seen it before. The good thing, though, is with backticks, you can put your string over multiple lines, and you can embed expressions in there, which we'll see in a minute is quite useful. But here we've got a similar query as before. There are actually a few more things in here. We basically say, OK, get me the top movies and a bunch of properties of those. In this case, there is a parameter for that poster path. It's still hard-coded, but I could have made that a variable as well and passed that in when I execute the query. Whatever you need to do, both will work. So we still need to execute the query. We've got the provider, we've got the client to connect to the server, we've got the query, but we still need to execute that query. Well, that's where this query component comes in. The query component basically takes the query we specified. It searches for the provider to get at the Apollo client and then executes that query against the client. It's actually a bit more complex than that, but that's in a nutshell what happens. Turns out that it doesn't just execute it, it asks the client to execute it, and depending on how the client is configured, it can actually just execute it or do even more smart things with it. For instance, batching, which I'll come back to in a minute. But it will execute the query, and it will get back a result. And in this case, I've used the pattern where I've got a container component, which is about querying, and I've got a presentation component, which is about presenting. So in there, I'm just going to take the result of that query execution and render it. So there are a number of things, and actually, oh yeah, it's right at the top. So you can see the props being passed in is loading, error, and data. There are actually more props in there, but those are the three you typically want. So as long as the query is executing, this component will be rendered with loading being true. I was going to say truthy, but it's actually just true. And we can show some kind of spinner or something else, whatever you want to, maybe nothing. But at least you know there is no data yet. Now, if you do a query, we're going over HTTP to a server, things can fail. You might not have network connectivity, the query might be wrong or so. It shouldn't be, but it could be if the server changed since the client was deployed. So there might be an error. So there is an error object, and that could be some kind of, or could be any kind of error. You could have your own shape in there. In this case, I'm just expecting a message property in there, which is typically the case. But could be much more complex. Assuming that we've loaded and there is no error, we'll actually have data in there. That's only present once we've loaded. And we'll have a property on there which matches up with the query. So the query we did was for top-rated movies. So data has a top-rated movies item on there, which is the result of that query. Well, in this case, we were asking for a collection of movies. So this is going to be an array, and all the movie objects with the properties we asked for are going to be in there. So I'm just going to map over that and have another element or another React component display those. So that's kind of nice. But if you looked at that GraphQL query I had a few slides back, it was kind of large. Like, I had everything listed in there. And the query component, which executes, doesn't actually use any of that. It doesn't know what you should use. So a much better way of defining your query is to use something called fragments. And a fragment is basically saying, well, each component describes its own data needs. And then whenever one component decides to render another component for a specific part of the UI, it doesn't just import and render that component. It also asks that component, okay, what data requirements do you have? What query fragment are you going to provide? So here I've got the query for the movie list, which basically says, well, I'm going to render a list. Well, React requires that there is a key property, and that's unique, so we specify the ID for that. But the actual data we're going to render, it defers to another component, so it doesn't actually know. So what it does is import that and basically specify that here as a fragment, and then with the triple dot do or put all those individual items in there. So they will get queried. It's just like we don't know exactly if we look here what it is. But now I'm at the level where I can make changes to one single component. I want to show more movie details. Fine, I go into the movie detail component, add properties there to the query and to the rendered markup, and that's the only change we have to make, which is really nice, just local changes. So here's the query at the higher level. Like, where we execute the query, we're not using anything of the data itself, so we're just saying, okay, get me the fragment of whatever it needs to load. So this is a fragment which contains other fragments, etc., and everything will be loaded. So I said that we could do some more advanced stuff with the executing. Well, by default, if we just use that Apollo link provider, or sorry, the boost link, then everything would just execute. But it turns out if you're asking for different data sets, that would mean different HTTP requests. And that kind of slows things down a bit, and there is a limit on how many requests the browser can do. So you typically want as few requests as you can do. Well, turns out there is this nice class, the HTTP batch, or the batch HTTP link, I should say, which is a specialization of the normally used HTTP link. And HTTP link just says, okay, execute. The batch HTTP link is slightly smarter. It says, well, okay, you want to execute a query to the server. Let's see if something else wants to execute a query. And it, at least by default, it's going to wait 10 milliseconds. And 10 milliseconds, quite a lot of JavaScript code can execute. So if after 10 milliseconds it's seen additional queries, it's actually going to group those together and issue one request to the server for all of those. And when they come back, it will split them actually out back to their original results and hand them off to the right query object. So we get fewer requests. Now, Apollo Boost, the client I was using before, is actually quite configurable, but the one thing you can't configure is which link provider it should use. So it uses HTTP link, and you can specify the URI, but you can't tell it to use the batched one. Probably will really soon. I actually tried to do a pull request to add that, and adding that was really simple. The only thing I didn't finish my pull request is I couldn't figure out how to write a proper unit test for it. So much for test-driven development. We can still do it, though, but now I'm still using Apollo Client, but if you look at the imports, Apollo Client now comes from a different module. It comes from Apollo Client and not Apollo Boost. Small change. The only difference is Apollo Boost has the sensible defaults. Apollo Client doesn't. So we have to specify a bit more. The one thing you have to specify is this cache, which is actually the default from Apollo Boost. So slightly more work, not a lot, but now we've got batched queries. So that's querying data, which is really nice. And very few applications don't have to do that. But occasionally, we also have to update data. It's just like if you just query data and you show it to the users, you can do a lot of interesting stuff, but occasionally, users will have to make changes. And even in an example like I've got where I'm just showing movies, I've got this little vote up and vote down button. And let's actually quickly show that application. I'm only showing the genres. Let me make a small change. Nope, wrong class. Let me show the movies instead of the genres. So we see the top rated movies, and I've got these vote up and vote down buttons. So we want something like that. Or maybe you want a complete data entry form to do stuff, but you want to be able to make some changes. Well, like I already said in the beginning, with REST, you would just send a resource back to the server with an HTTP put, probably. In this case, we're using a mutation, sort of a remote procedure call, where we're very explicit about what we want to change. So we're going to write another query, but in this case, the query is not for querying data, it's for updating data. So we have to prefix it with the mutation keyword. And then we give it some name, rate movie. So that's the name the client is actually going to use internally. So use whatever you want. And it has some parameters, the movie ID and the vote we're going to pass on to it. And then inside of it, it has the function on the server it's going to call, also called rate movie in this case, because that name just makes sense. But the top rate movie is the client name. The bottom one is the server name. And we pass all the parameters into that. And we also specify what result we want. Like if everything goes well, there are no errors, I just want the ID of the movie back, which we should kind of know because we're passing that in. And I also want the new vote average and vote count back so we can see how things changed. So we've got our query object. Now we still need to execute it. Well, when we query data, we use a query object. When we mutate data, guess what? Use the mutation object or component. So we've got the mutation component. You specify the mutation GraphQL query we want to do. It uses the same render props method as the query did. It will call us back with a function, and then we render whatever UI we want, passing in that function, and whenever we call that function, our server is actually called. Typically, you want to update caches, so there is also this update function which you can use after the fact. Okay, my query was executed, it did something, I need to make state changes on the client. Okay, well, that's the function. You can do it. It will get the result from the mutation back, in this case, the new vote average and vote count and the ID of the movie, so it can do something useful. So how would you use that? Well, with a really simple component again. Got a little button, and in the onClick, I just call that rate movie, and I pass in the variables I want. So if we go back to the query for a moment here, you can see there are two variables defined, the ID and the vote. Those are the ones you pass in when you call that mutation function, and they will be sent to the server. So that's these two variables, ID and movie. So quite easy to do, but very explicit about what we're going to update. Of course, the server doesn't have to accept any update. It can return errors again. Your client can respond to those, but whatever you want. No different from REST or services. So the conclusion, I really like GraphQL. For me, it's a great way to consolidate multiple endpoints, or even if I had a single RESTful endpoint, to replace it with GraphQL. The fact that I've got a type system and I can test my queries and validate them and use them in the playground is really easy. The fact that I can use the same API from different clients and just specify on each client what exactly I want back. The big website with the large screen shows a lot of data. My Android application shows a smaller amount of data, so it doesn't have to get all that data back over HTTP. Before, I would hit multiple endpoints to get all the data back. Now I had a single endpoint, and that endpoint actually consolidates the data. It can do it whatever, like a trivial initial implementation of that server would be just hit the original multiple endpoints. And then later you can refine that. Updates, really nice. I think it's much better than REST, where you just send resources back, and that quite often doesn't match quite well. So doing mutations and the SQL REST pattern is much, much better in that regard. So I really like GraphQL. Now, is it the silver bullet which is going to fix all networking issues, all querying and update issues? Nope. Silver bullet hasn't been invented yet, and probably never will. But it's a big step forward. Like, way, way back, RPC, then SOAP, then REST, and now GraphQL is the next step along that line.